Hello guys, in this video I will talk about method overloading because I realized some of the concepts still we have to know in the method overloading, right? So one of the important interview questions you will get, is it possible to overload the main method? So let me make one example called example 6. In this example, first I will create a main method, main control space bar enter. And then in interview, you might get a question, is it possible to overload the main method? Now write one print statement and print this, right? So your answer will be yes. Your answer will be yes. The reason is, when we overload the main method, it will work as a normal method, right? Let me overload a main method. Just I will not keep a string array argument, I will just keep a string argument, and one more main method I will make, and here I will write integer type of data, right? So this main method, if you look at here, now it's overloaded. Now let me change the print statement for all the overloaded method. Now what happens when we run this program, since we have the main method, and as we know that the main method is the one from where the actual execution will start. So it's actually entry point of the execution. So when you do run a Java applications, you'll get output as a main string argument. So this main is getting called. This main is getting called. So what happens is, though your main method is overloaded, but when you just run the program, your this main method will get called. Now to call other overloaded method, what you can do is, it's a normal way, it's, since it is a static method, we can just call by class name. So you can just call class dot main, and you can just supply argument call 5. So when I supply 5, my this main method will get called. Okay, so right click, run as Java applications, and you do proceed. So you can see that both are getting called, but in here you should not try a main method with a string with array of argument. You should not try this, guys. Okay, you know what will happen when you try? So this will go into the recursion. This will always call this string, this main method, and again it will come here, and again this will call. So if I show you here, this will go into the infinite loop. It will be like recursions, one method calling other method. See, it will call, and then see, it was calling continuously. You can see that main string, and after some point of time you will get, you know, out of memory. So here if you look at, let me show you, yeah, here a stack overflow, you will get a stack overflow. So you should never do like that, otherwise this will go into the recursion, right? So you should not call that. So even you can overload the main method, which is perfectly fine. Now I will talk about the data type promotion, right? So the data type promotions, what happens is, let me make one example first. Example 7, right? Now, so here we need to understand the the data type promotions. Here if you look at, byte is smaller than sort, sort is smaller than integer, integer is short than long, long is short than float, and the float is short than double, which means automatically double will take all the data, byte, sort, int, long, float. Float will take all the data, byte, sort, int, long. Long will take all the data, byte, sort, int. Int will take byte, sort, and sort will take byte, right? So why I am explaining this here, let's say you have a overloaded method, this we call it as a data promotion, right? Or data type promotion. So let's say we have a method called public void test one. One method we have, and here what we have is, we have a long l comma one more long l1. Okay, so let me make this as a L1 and let me make this as a L2, right? Now we have one more method where we have double, right? And again we have a double. In this case, what happens is, let me write one print statement. In this print statement, I will try to print this data. Same thing I will copy here. Okay. Now I will make a main method. In main method, I will create the object of the class. Now what I am going to do is, I will call a test1 method and I will supply 20 tab 10. See here, this both the data is integer type of data. Okay, both the data is integer type of data. Now you have this long and you have double. You are not, you know, giving double and you are not giving long type of data. You are giving that integer type of data. Now if you run this program, let's see that what happens. So when we run this program here, this is getting called, test1 is getting called, right? Why? Because the long will accept integer. That is the reason here data promotion is happening, right? This guy is calling this method. But let's say what I will do is, same thing I will write here, like 20.98 something. Now let's see that which method this will get called. Okay, now if I run that, the same program, see here, now double is getting called. See, this is automatic data promotion is happening, automatic on the runtime. The decision is, you know, happening which method need to be called, right? So JVM will decide. So what happened is, here the second was 10, which is an integer, but the first was double. So first, you know, JVM will look for a method which has double and integer, but we don't have. Then it will look for a method which will accept this data. So this test1 method will accept this data, because double will take your decimal also, as well as it will take integer also. That is the reason when we'll call this method, automatic this data will get called, right? Now let me make one more method, and what I will do is, I will write float, and here also I will write float. Okay, I have a float and float. Now let's see what happens. Float, we know that it will accept decimal, and I will write 10.0. okay, now see that this method, actually if you don't have float, this test1 will get called. But now since we have a float, okay, the JVM will give preference to the method which has two float. Now let me run that, and then let's try to understand. Now see here, again you have double. Okay, again you have double, but as I said, if both are float, this will get called, but no, JVM is giving preference to double. But you want this float to be called, you can just put this word called f and f. Now you are making more specific, you call a method, right, with a data type float. Now this float will get called, because you are, now you are making that more specific, but by writing f, which means this float will get called. Run a Java applications. See here, now float is getting called because I made more specific. So this, in method overloading, we call it as a data promotions or type promotions. Now there is a one situations, right, where you will get a compile time error. Let me make a class. Example 8. Here there is a situations where we have a method public void sum, the sum method, right? And here what we have is, so let me first write a body. Okay, here we have, let's say, int I comma double d. Okay, we have this. Now we have one more method where we have double and then we have int, and let me write one print statement here. In this print statement, I will try to print this method. Again, I will write one more print statement. In this print statement, I will print this. Now here the problem what happens is, when I will make a main method, sorry, it's not a main, it should be main, main method, yeah. When I make a main method, and now if I make the object of this class, and now if I call obj.sum, and if I'll call 20, comma let's say 10, see, in this case you will get a compile time error, because here, you know, actually compiler will not understand that you are actually, when at the compile time itself you will get a compile time error. The problem what happens is, you have an integer, you have a double, now you have a double and you have an integer. So the problem here is, this 20 even double will accept, this 10 integer will accept, but this 20 even integer will accept, and even 10 the double will accept. Now there will be an ambiguity, right? In case of ambiguity, you will get a compile time error. So you should not write this kind of overloaded method. To avoid this, if I write one more overloaded method, then issue will go off. If I write intent, then issue will go off. Compile time error will also go off. Then there is no point of writing these two overloaded method. Okay, you should not write like that. Okay, so though you change the data sequence, but you make sure that when you are changing the data sequence, your method will be overloaded, you will not get any problem. But when you will call the method, you will have an issue, because here the compiler will not understand which method need to be called, right? You can see that, because 20 integer will take, 10 double will take, again here 20 double will take, and again 10 integer will take. So in that case you will get a compile time error, right? So I think, I believe 99% concept has been covered in method overloading. Maybe 1-2% will be remaining, which I will come to know. I'll upload a video. Thank you guys. Thank you for watching this.